Thank you everyone for joining us today for this vision. We have a really special speaker coming in, so definitely something worth a break. So I'd like to introduce Professor Nancy Cartwright. Nancy Cartwright is a professor of philosophy at University of Durham and a distinguished professor of philosophy at University of California, San Diego, where she's the director of the Center for Humanities in the Aging Science and Society. Her research interests have been the philosophy and history of science. She's worked on modeling, causal inference, causal powers, objectivity, evidence, and evidence-based policy. She's written 11 books, and she recently won the 2018 Hempel Award for a lifetime achievement in the philosophy of science. We're really, really happy that Nancy is able to come out and, you know, give a talk to our fellow student society. So, thank you so much, Nancy. Without further ado, I'll take it away.
Thank you, everybody. It's great to be back at St. Andrews. I love St. Andrews. I've been here often, and it's always nice to get back and after a wonderful lunch talking about philosophy and better philosophy and the kinds of problems we have in philosophy. Anyway, let me get started on the talk. So theory, and me, I don't know if you know anything about my career, but I'm reputed to be anti-theory. Here's a quote, Cartwright's anti-realist about fundamental laws, they are not even approximately true. We find in philosophy physics going anti-theory, think for example of Nancy. So, today I defend theory, okay? But even big theory, but big in what sense? That's the question. Not high theory, as in grand social theories like those of Sensenon, Marx, or Butler, nor deep, as in fundamental, like Einstein, Darwin, or Arnold. Big in the sense of wide, resplendent. I think resplendent was in one of the titles that was distributed. As in lots and lots of theory. A good many of the theories are going to be little and middling. Because the slogan is, quantum theory alone cannot dull a laser. Which is how I actually learned this lesson. Since I studied a lot of quantum theory, and when I went to Stanford, I loved the fact that quantum theory actually helped us improve things in the world, and I tried to learn about lasers, and it turned out I knew absolutely nothing. There was nothing I knew that was useful to learn, and I had to go to the engineering department, and I studied with laser engineering physicists, and I did study in the physics department. This is what I was teaching at Stanford, I was going to go on. Okay. So, quantum theory alone cannot build you a laser nor test the general theory of relativity. So, I worked for a while as a participant observer on the Stanford Gravity Probe Experiment, which is headed by Francis Everett, who is an Englishman who has been at Stanford almost, you know, all of his professional life. They put gyroscopes into space to see if they persist due to coupling, space-time coupling, and the space-time curvature. And they had to make these perfectly homogeneous gyroscopes so that they could actually see the precession, the very tiny precession that would be due to space-time coupling. And the thing that impressed me was, you know, just everything that mattered so much to getting this experiment to run properly. And I think there were 40 volumes of notes about the theories, some big but mostly little, that were essential to the design of the experiment to actually get it to be done in the right way, so that if you thought you saw a precession, you really were seeing it. So that's what started my thinking along these lines. So these building laser or testing the GTR takes lots and lots and lots of pieces and lots of teamwork, and you need lots of teamwork from a vast set of theories of different sizes and sorts. So science, we know, produces wonderful products. So here's a bunch of them. The one up there in the upper right-hand corner is the Oxford knee, made by my neighbor, and he works in a team of mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, physiologists, cell specialists, etc. And anyway, there's tons of things that science has done for us. Sort of devices and products, you know, but besides that, we do have devices, but besides devices, we produce millions and millions of absolute marvelous models that are good for understanding, description, prediction, measures, like how do you measure poverty or social exclusion, or how do you measure the charge on an electron, and what counts as a measure, not just what operations you carry out on the ground, but if you're going to measure poverty, you have to actually design a measure. You have to say what you mean by poverty, you have to provide a representation of it, you have to provide procedures on the ground, and you have to show that they all fit together. So when there's a lot involved in doing this practical science, then we, you know, studies, experiments, theories, and so forth. So if you want these to be reliable, says me, you would best employ lots and lots and lots and lots of theory of lots of different kinds and scales. So I sometimes get accused of being opposed to high theory. I'm not opposed to high theory. I think we need it. I mean, I think we can't get the laser without it. You can't build a laser from quantum theory by itself. So I'm happy with grand theories. What I'm not happy with is not with grand takeovers. So for instance, here we have probably a quote you've often seen from Stephen Hawking. We might have a complete, consistent, and unified theory which would describe all possible observations. So we don't need, I've heard these guys say, you don't need social science. You just have to figure out what we do implies about the social world. Here's another one. Now this is somebody with a takeover theory in about society, which is Gary Becker, won a Nobel Prize for this kind of work. He says, economic aspects apply to human aspects of human behavior, which had previously been dealt with, if at all, by other social science disciplines, such as sociology, demography, and criminology. So he had a technique, right, for modeling what he claimed, you know, so he could use his economic models to figure out family relationships and so forth. Well, it didn't actually work. It's this kind of takeover, the idea that we can have, in principle, one grand theory that's going to do everything for us. I think we need theory. We need the grand theory, we need lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of little theories, and they have to work together the right way. So, many of you have already been thinking about things like this, if you've been doing epistemology courses, because your big thing now over the last couple decades has been social epistemology, where it's not this. Right? I mean, knowledge doesn't, you couldn't even have knowledge inside your own head if you didn't live in a society and have knowledge as a community enterprise and a community possession. So that's a route into this way of thinking from very conventional philosophy. So instead, of the Cartesian picture, we have something more like this in social epistemology for actually securing knowledge. What I'm really arguing, essentially, the basis for which I'm arguing is really my predecessor at the London School of Economics, Karl Popper, his doctrines writ large. So Popper worried about, argued that without a big set of lots and lots of theories of lots of sorts and sizes, most of the concepts we have are meaningless, they're empty. You need really to nail down the meaning of this, and it's not going to work by giving some necessary and sufficient conditions that use some other terms, unless you've got this whole network of big and little theories that actually flesh out the concepts that you're using. And your equations and your principles are going to be equally, if you don't have a lot of work that ties them to the world in various different ways, their content of their equations and principles are going to be contentless. Popper said, these guys had theories that were empty, and my feeling was, he described the reason that theories are empty is they don't have enough grip to decide one way or another what the world should be like. But what makes the theories, a makes them able to do that isn't something about just them themselves, it's that there's this whole network of other scientific work in which they're embedded and which help flesh them out. And whether or not one could have, we don't have that with Marx, we don't have that with Freud, and they're bringing both physical and social science theories that we don't have that with. Now, whether there's something particularly difficult about society, or whether we've got, we haven't quite got the right principles, or whether we just haven't invested the right way in finding all the other little theories that help flesh them out. that's one of the things I think that's excuse me, diagnosis of some of the problems in social science and social science theories that actually have sufficient content and us having sufficient practical knowledge of what that content is and what it really implies to make it useful. Okay. So I'm going to illustrate today development economics. This is Angus Deaton, who won the Nobel Prize in economics a couple years ago for his work on really working with data. And Angus says, do a big theory in economics, supply and demand, arbitrage. My guess is we have lots of little theories, often contradictory, and we switch among them according to purpose. Then here's another economist writing about the same thing, Danny Roderick. And he says, this is a review. Roderick insists that economic activity defies universal laws. Economists embrace their expertise as a set of tools, not a grand unified theory. They can improve the world. Rather than a single specific model, economics encompasses a collection. Different social settings require different models. And economists are unlikely ever to uncover universal general purpose models. That's my view about economics. I'm just arguing from authority here. Roderick insists that economic activity defies universal laws, but you know, we've got to have a set of tools. But I think it's got to be a very big set. So this is my image of science. I have a bit of a problem. I hope the question and answer, I might get you to help me, because I have two very different images I'm using at the moment. One is that Meccano set, and there's another problem is that Meccano aficionados, who really continue still to build wonderful Meccano devices, independent of gender, they're all called Meccano men. But I don't know if I can actually have a book that's titled The Meccano Man of Science or something like that. The other image, I'll explain to you if you want later, is of Chicano bird's nest, which is woven together from lots and lots and lots of ingredients, but it floats on water just like the robot told us our knowledge in science does. So they're two quite different images. meant to capture different aspects. But this one is you need lots and lots of different kinds of tools and you put them together in different ways and do these marvelous things. So here's my plan. I'm going to look today at an egregious case of theory denialism in economics. It's going to look at economics. And it's a case that matters. It matters in principle and it matters in practice to people's lives and hopes. And that's the randomized controlled trial, where theory is out, and it's out in the interest of rigor. So our randomized controlled trials are flavor of the month throughout the UK, US, Canada, in social policy. We have all these work centers in the UK that is taxpayer, we spend a lot of money on, but in particular, they're a big thing in so, I want to think about rigorous methods because theory is out. We've got this method, we're going to use it and not consult any theory. And the reason we're going to do that is because we want rigor, and that's what we're taught. And so, I've looked through what people say and what you could actually say in defense of randomized controlled trials. And I think there's two criteria that are being used when we're claiming that they're rigorous and more rigorous than anything else. One is that there's a valid argument. So you have a method. Methods have come with a list of assumptions that should be satisfied if the method's going to be applicable. and then you use the method, but did not come. And the valid argument is that if the assumptions of the method are satisfied, then if you add the outcome, you can actually have a valid argument from that to the conclusion. So I mean, you really are bootstrapping up from an outcome, in the case of randomized control trials, deductively. You bootstrap up from the outcome to a causal conclusion by a deductive argument, but of course the deductive argument involves the assumptions that are supposed to be satisfied if the method has been applied correctly. Okay, so there's a valid argument. And then the second thing is, then we'll just warranted premises. So I'm going to give you examples of places where methods used in the social and environmental and human sciences for drawing causal conclusions, where I can show you a valid argument that from the kind of outcome they should produce, if the assumptions are satisfied, then the causal conclusion follows deductively. And it's not just randomized controlled trials, there's a whole slew of them. So the assumptions plus the empirical input plus the causal conclusion, you get this in literally controlled experiments, like the Stanford Gravity Probe, where they really control every other, and that was what was wonderful about it. It took them 20 years to put the gyroscopes in space. But when they put them up there, they were confident that they weren't doing any calculating away. They actually controlled away all the other possible causes of precession. So controlled experiments, natural experiments, instrumental variables models that are used in economics, econometric models that satisfy special conditions, qualitative comparative analysis, so long as it satisfies special conditions, causal Bayes' nets methods, which I was talking to people about at lunch, process tracing, and derivation from theory. All of these, you can write down what the assumptions required are. Now you don't always know that they're satisfied. You can write down a set of assumptions such that you get the outcome, and if those assumptions were satisfied, the causal conclusion would follow deductively. I can do that for every single one of them. So, what's so special about the randomized controlled trial? These are not rigorous, say, all these guys who like RCTs and all our what work centers, right? Top gold standard for causal conclusions is randomized controlled trials, and all other kind of evidence is really not very good. So what's wrong with these? Why are they not rigorous? Well, as far as I can tell, what's rigorous is, as I say, the randomized controlled trials. So here's the British Medical Journal, randomized controlled trials are the most rigorous. Here's GRADE, which is a standard evidence, a set of criteria for ranking evidence, and evidence that's produced by a randomized controlled trial, or looking at a cluster of randomized controlled trials, it's always at the top. Okay. Here's another. This is from an American site, the Department of Education sponsors a What Works Clearinghouse in Education. Randomized controlled trials are the gold standard. And JPAL, do you guys know what JPAL? So it's the General Poverty Action Lab. It's in MIT America, run mostly by MIT economists in the US. And it's been big business in development economics. And as Andy Speakey told me when I first started working with him on randomized controlled trials, these guys are good guys. And we object to their work on randomized controlled trials, but these people are really serious about development and poverty, and they, the first generation, go to the countries and really spend time there and know the problems. What's worrying to me is that these are the good guys, and I think they're making methodological mistakes. And could you better? Okay. But you see, this is from their website, randomized controlled trials and most rigorous. So here they are. This is this year's winners of the Nobel Prize in Economics. And all three of them have worked at JPAL, and two of them are still at MIT. So Banerjee, Duflo, and Kramer, and many of you might or ought to have read the book Poor Economics by Duflo and Banerjee, or is it Banerjee and Duflo? I've got quite a lot of names here, where they tell you that we don't know how to do really serious business that needs to be done, that governments are corrupt and they don't care about their citizens, but we should go for low-hanging fruit. And low-hanging fruit is things like, well, the big thing that many of you might know about because it's been big in philosophy is deworm the world. Giving kids deworming probe. Two studies in two Kenyan sites giving kids deworming pills help their immune scores. And from that, there's a big movement because it sounds makes sense. So there's the deworming world movement based on this two randomized control trials. They also look to see whether or not you can use flip charts so you'll get better reading results, whether it's better. So malarial bed nets, we all know that when there are two competing dispositions, people with scarce resources might put their money elsewhere rather than what they think the long run would be better for them because it's a short-term press of needs, so you should give them away free. On the other hand, we also have a human disposition, widespread human disposition to not value what you don't have to work for. So maybe you should charge a small amount of money. So they did some randomized controlled trials to see which of these dominated in their study population. I think this is crazy because, it seems to me which dominates in a particular population is going to depend really intimately on who's in the population and what their exact conditions are. But anyway, that's the kind of thing that they meant by low hanging fruit. And let's figure out whether you and that's why for some. And they won the Nobel Prize, okay, for their introducing this new experiment-based approach into development economics. And that is an experimental approach to alleviating global poverty. It says in the Nobel Committee says they've been helping alleviate global poverty doing this. I'm sure I can find evidence, though not RCT evidence, that they have been hugely influential in making randomized controlled trials popular in development economics. I don't think we can find evidence that it's alleviating global poverty. It's kind of odd to me that they have this high standard of evidence. I mean, they didn't give themselves the Nobel Prize, but that it's not backed up, the claims were badly backed up. So here's Deaton again. He's written another paper on randomized controlled trials, and in it has a section on RCTs are rigorous and scientific. Question, that's the question. This rhetoric is rarely, if ever, justified. The adjectives are used as code words for randomized controlled trials. Frequently so, the rhetoric appears to be successful, at least with funders. Okay. So, what's so good about RCTs? Well, one thing that's supposed to be, I showed you all those ones that have methods that have, I have reduced out of arguments for. The thing about randomized controlled trials is they're supposed to have credible premises. When I said I thought there were two conditions that these guys were requiring when they wanted, when they said RCTs are the most rigorous. And one was that there's a valid argument, but then they don't like any of the other methods in which there are valid arguments. So I think the thing about isolating that they really do mean they have credible premises. And the credibility is supposed to be the premises are credible because they're secured by design alone without need for any theory. That's the story of why RCTs are better than all these other methods. Because remember, I said some of our assumptions have to be met. They claim that the assumptions that need to be met from RCT can be met by design alone. You don't have to import any substantive assumptions from anywhere else. And because they've got the view that inevitably, if you use theory, it's going to be unreliable. Two famous economists talking about criticizing assumptions. There's been something called the credibility revolution in economics. It has to do with let's stop importing assumptions that we can't defend, and let's just use it. Okay. Angus and Bishke, two LSE former colleagues of mine, talk about the credibility revolution. What they're worried about again is let's stop using these non-credible assumptions. My former colleague Julian Rice, who's also a good positive economics, econometricians often find one another's assumptions incredible. So, assumptions is a code word here for theory. They don't want to be made brainy and poorly made theory, whether it's big, little, or middle. They just eliminate all of that. So let's look at the RCT. I'm going to go through this really quick because I just want you to see that validity. I'm going to show you a proof. I'm not going to go through the proof, but so actually, believe me. So what you want, what we'd really like to know, is really like to know, is whether or not if I offer Spencer a malarial bed net for free, is he going to use it? Right? And when I'm interested in how much giving it away for free difference will make to the outcome for Spencer. That's the individual treatment effect. How much, if I did this treatment, how much difference would it make to Spencer? So it's a kind of factual. If I were to give it to him for free versus if I did, what would the difference be? Probably everything else fixed. I mean, we just want to know what the effect of that is. That's an individual treatment effect. And hey, something we all know about philosophy, it's kind of factual. And you can't directly measure a counterfactual. I can't both give it to Spencer and not give it to him at the same time under the same conditions and see what he does. So the individual treatment aspect for a unit is a counterfactual, the difference between the outcomes Spencer would experience if treated versus untreated. Now, the average treatment effect, say for everybody in this room, right, is just the average of the individual treatment effects across all of us. So, now, the sad news is what I just said, you can't directly measure the individual treatment effect for anybody. But the really fantastic news, and this is what's wonderful about randomized controlled trials, is you can estimate the average for a population even though you can't measure it on any individual in the population. And I was just astounded when I realized that. Because the way I do averages is I write down, what are the marks in my class? I write down everybody's name, I write the mark beside it, and I total them up, divide by the total number of students in the class. And you can't do that, and yet you can estimate the average for a population using a randomized controlled trial. And that's pretty impressive. I'm not going to explain to you how the proof that shows that, but I do want to point out that it starts with something called the potential outcome equation. And what you have in this equation is you have the effect on the left and the cause of interest on the right. If anybody knows anything about Mackey and Inness conditions, this is just Inness conditions on four. This isn't a sign that people know about this, don't worry about it. Inness conditions are for yes, no variables, and this is just exactly Mackey's theory for continuous variables. So what you think is, I've got an effect, and it may or might not be caused by my treatment. And this is for you, for an individual, for still Thomas Spencer. It may or might not be caused by our treatment, which is X. And then there's a whole lot of other stuff, independently, that might also affect him, than whether it's given away for free or not. And that's not what we're interested in. We're just interested in how much difference X makes, and that'll be adjusted by other factors about Spencer, that how much oomph does the treatment really give depends on a lot of other factors. You know, standard philosopher's example is striking a match will give you a flame, but there's no oxygen in the room. So beta it contains a reference, for instance, to the oxygen. And if there's no oxygen, beta's gonna be zero. And even though it's really could be a really powerful method. So you start with this potential outcome equation, and it turns out beta turns out to be the individual treatment effect. Because if you think about what happens, if you look at the maths, right, the difference between x equals 1 and x equals 0, getting rid of the w's, right, and the w's are the same, the difference between x equals 1 and x equals 0 just is beta. So how much the treatment affects Spencer depends on the value, the net effect of all these other factors that modify, called interactive variables or moderator variables or support factors. So now, validity. Point is, there's a valid argument. So what you do at the end of the experiment is you measure the average outcome in the treatment group. You measure the average outcome. So you all know that like a randomized controlled trial, you randomly assign people to be in the treatment group and the control group, and then you give them the treatment, and you do, if you're really good, you have quadruple blinding, so they don't know which group they're in, the administrators don't know, the people who measure the outcomes don't know, the people who do the statistical analysis don't know. So you do all that, and then you measure the outcome over here, the average outcome over here, the average outcome over there, subtract, right? Hoping this one's bigger than that one's. And if that measurement gives you number 5, there's a valid argument that takes you from 5 to tell you that 5 is an unbiased estimate of the average treatment effect in the study population. Okay, that's what I'm not going to go through. Now, the problem is, what about the credibility of the premises? So the estimate 8 average treatment effect is rigorous, supposing. Well, the thing I put up at the very top, supposing that the study population actually can be described by a neutral outcome equation, that there's a kind of systematic way in which various factors contribute to the effect, and supposing something called orthogonality, which I'm explaining in a minute. So the issue of credibility is you assume one, which nobody ever talks about one, they just all start out assuming this real systematicity across the population, to causality, and then 2. So it's 2 I want to talk about, because that's the quantum. What about orthogonality? Well, what orthogonality is that the assignment, the treatment, whether you get the treatment or not, is totally independent of anything else that would affect the effect. Okay, so the treatment group, that's why you do all this blinding. You don't want to have any other things sneaking in that affect the outcome than the treatment. So the only difference between the two groups is you bring the treatment into one and one into the other. So you've got this probabilistic independence between the other causal factors. If you have probabilistic independence, that's orthogonality between the other factors, the other causal factors of the outcome, and the treatment, you're home free. So if you've got orthogonality, then you get this valid argument. Okay? So now, how do you get orthogonality? How do you get this independence? Well, I already told you what you do, is you do random assignment. And random assignment, so you just flip a coin and decide which of you are going in the treatment group, which are going in the control group. And random assignment will assure that you have orthogonality at the moment of assignment. It's just total chance whether, whatever other characteristics you have, it's total chance whether you're in treatment or control. So at the moment of assignment, it's independent. Problem is, after that, anything can happen. And we know some of the things that can happen, that's why we do all that quadruple blinding. But that's not enough. I mean, first of all, this isn't theory independent. We actually do the blinding because we have theories about conscious and unconscious biases, and placebo effect, and other lots of other ones. But somehow that gets swept under the rug, that actually is the intrusion theory. But I want to talk about lots else can happen. I read just recently about a study where wanted to find the effects of a new heart treatment in local hospitals. So the hospitals that were going to be able to deliver this treatment were randomly, the treatment was randomly assigned to some hospitals and not others. And apparently, you couldn't really keep it a secret which hospitals had the treatment. All the good doctors ran over to work in the hospitals that had the new treatment. So, well, you might have orthogonality at base, but it was just totally messed up afterwards. And you actually had to know something, right, to notice that. I mean, it's not hard to notice, but. Okay, so randomized controlled trials aren't so rigorous after all. They don't secure, you read all the time, honestly, I can find, where randomization secures orthogonality. And it doesn't. Right? Randomization plus really, really good policing afterwards that requires lots of knowledge and assumptions and theory, that can give you a good reason to believe it. works. Okay? RCT conclusions. Well, so what's the claim that an RCT conclusion gives you good results for? Well, one is the average treatment effect of X on Y in this population was 6 or 0.2. X caused Y in some units in our population. X causes Y widely everywhere. Or X caused Y in some units in the population. Or it would or will cause, it, or X will cause in some other population. The ones that are circled in green are the ones you can get. And that's it. Not the others. So RCTs are good for post-hoc evaluation. If you want to know, nowadays in Britain we often have social programs and pay by results. So you're going to offer a tuition program, a new tuition program in schools, and we're going to pay you only if you actually achieve bringing up reading scores. And we don't want to pay you if it happens that lots of other stuff is going on and all the other things we were doing for our students, pupils brought up the reading scores, we're going to pay you if you broke them up. So how do we know that? Well, that's, we look for, after the fact, you know, can we have evidence that your reading program caused an improvement in this school? So that's post hoc evaluation. Randomized control trials are really good for that if you can do them properly. That's what they're good for. And that's what you can really nail down. But you know, usually what you want to know about is some new population. So studies, actually I keep drawing this point, studies show results about objects studied, and no amount of study design can make a study give results. Let me go back here. No amount of study design can make a study give results about things not studied. So here we have Mary Berry, and she's going to taste that piece of cake. She's not tasting that one, she's not tasting that one, that one, that one. And she can't make judgments about this, sitting there tasting the other piece. Okay. So let's go back to these guys. Okay. Recall, RCTs are supposed to produce reliable results all by themselves, but designed without incredible assumptions, without theories. So what are they reliable for? Recall, well, what you can do is you can get out of an RCT, it works somewhere. You know, it worked in that population. Well, everybody knows that. And the people who won this Nobel Prize know that. But nevertheless, let me show you something. This is from a paper by Duflo and Kramer. I wasn't cherry picking, I wasn't hunting. It's in the second paragraph of the paper. I just noticed it. So, I'm going to just let you see here what. The second paragraph, in one sentence, they seamlessly slide between three different kinds of causal claim without mentioning it or noticing it. So, benefits of knowing which programs work. Well, which programs work sounds to me like it works widely, works generally, can be taken as a default position in some kind of general claim. Extend far beyond any program or agency, incredible impact evaluations. Impact evaluation, that's post-hoc evaluation, okay? That's it works somewhere. Can provide reliable guidance. Reliable guidance looks to me like it's going to work here. So they seamlessly slide between it works in general, it works somewhere, it will work here in this population, as if, right, they're all the same, when they're really dramatically different. And that's loose talk. I don't think I'll go through this too much. I mean, they do. Real, I mean, everybody knows this. So then they start talking about doing replications. Right? I mean, really, they know they can only have established it works somewhere. So then, well, let's just do a few more places. More and more study results, you know this. But I think, you know, there are 2,000 swans in the Thames, and they're all white. And in the right season, there are more than 40,000 swans in the UK, and they're all white. And that's what happens in Sydney Harbour. So just piling up a few more RCTs is just induction by simple enumeration. It worked here, it worked there. Guess it works everywhere, right? Without theory. I mean, I don't mean that you can't use this as sort of building a case, but induction by simple enumeration is, as Francis Bacon told us, pure. So, when we were told X is reliable, says, me, what we need to know is reliable for what? And as I said, it's not my full sort of question, as with our randomized controlled trials. So RCTs even pile up in a handful of them, or they're not reliable for it works, or it will work here. And actually, Duflo and Kerner admit this. I mean, it's really funny because they talk about, you know, on one page they say something different from what they've implied on another. Here they admit that they're only going to get any further guided by theory. But they sweep a lot under the rug there when they're talking about guided by theory, because they don't go into it at all. Theory must here be a way of alluding to the great set of theories of all sorts and sizes needed for reliable outputs. So how can we use theories to put RCTs to work, besides somehow trying to justify induction by simple emulation? So that's the closing question. How do you get from short-run RCT responses to long-run responses? I'm not going to go through this because we don't have enough time. It's just there's been nice work done doing that, but it imported quite a lot of theory done in particular by Cantera. And he talked about the Rand Health randomizer. So if you want to see, you can have a slide if you want. You know, what Arrow did and what kind of theory he used to get from short run experiments in the short run to come up with a conclusion about the long run. So what does it take to predict what a program will produce here? Yes, it says me. doing an induction by simple enumeration on these cases I've looked at, or actually doing this philosophical analysis actually trying to figure out what the conclusions look like and what it would take support them, you can't support theory that has concepts in it if you don't have any construct and concept validity, if you don't have measures, if you don't have operation procedures, if you don't have the kind of thing of opposite that's missing in Freud, thick network of things that will actually bridge principles that connect theory with the real world. So you need theory, more theory, mostly not grand, nor high, but small and mid-length and detailed. Okay. So, we don't understand for Gravity Probe. I said there's 40 volumes. Or the theories that you need to build a laser that works. Getting policy to work, well, that seems to me shouldn't be expected to be all that much easier than in the natural sciences, where we manage with quite a lot of work and by having to bring together laws. I want to give you a simple example in development economics. As it's a nice case. There was an integrated nutrition program. It was going to improve nutrition in infants and young children by educating mothers to feed them differently, even with scarce resources. The program, there was pretty good evidence that it really worked well in Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu was doing lots of other stuff as well, so they had to sort out, did it really contribute, or was it all the other things? But there was good evidence that this really did contribute to childhood nutrition in Tamil Nadu. It was tried in Bangladesh, and there's good evidence it did work in Bangladesh. Even 6 years later, it seemed not to be making much difference at all. So what's the difference between Tamil Nadu and Bangladesh? What went wrong? The story, the post-study evaluation said there were two problems, one was men, and there was mothers at home. here's the post-hoc evaluation. There are a couple of many things written on this, but here's the one. Program targeted the mothers of young children. Mothers are frequently not the decision makers and rarely the sole decision makers with respect to the health and nutrition of their children in Bangladesh. Women do not go to the market. Okay. It's the men who do the shopping. If you're educating the mothers, but it's the guys who are going out buying the food, and they're not paying any attention to what their wives are telling them they should buy. And for women enjoying low-income households, meaning they live with their mothers-in-law, as a sizable minority do, the mother-in-law has the women's domain. So, and you don't talk back to her anymore. She's dispensing the food, and she's, okay. So, so the story is that it's men and mothers-in-law. And just because we're, you know, philosophy gathering, it's, I think this is the Donald Davidson model. So we're Donald Davidson talk about how the fact reporter in column one of the New York Times caused the event reporter on column three on page five. Right? I mean, that can be true, can be undoubtedly true, but certainly it didn't happen under that description. That's not why it caused it, because it was reported on page one and it was reported on page one. There had to be a different description under which that causing happened. So that's the Donald Davidson problem, and that's what we're seeing here. Right? In Tamil Nadu, educating mothers, that was actually the wrong description of what was going on. We learned. I mean, that was, it was true, educating mothers, but that's like reported on the first page of the New York Times. What you were doing is we're educating those who control what food is procured, control how it gets dispensed, and hold the child's interests as paramount in doing so. And that, we learned later, right, would have been the right way to think about the description under which the cause was working. So, how do we do this? Well, I just want to point out that because just learning this kind of thing used a nice mix of theories. Here they used the people who did the postdoc evaluation, well, I showed you a picture, they used data from a Democratic and Health Survey, which is there. They used theory and more theory. We construct the comparison group using propensity score matching. So there's a lot of theory that goes into propensity score matching. They used it, right, in figuring out how to do the statistics correctly. They used focus groups, a lot of theory in how you run a focus group. From these came the memorable quote, "We'll start doing that once our mothers-in-laws have passed." there were ethnographies. So here's an ethnography full of real ethnographic knowledge. That is low-level theory, but it made a big difference to understanding what happened in Bangladesh. And then there were statistical techniques and econometric modeling, all of which is highly theory dependent. So here we have, you know, this is where you see that it made a difference whether we were a daughter-in-law or not, and that all that econometric modeling is, I don't know if you've ever taken an econometrics course, but a lot of theory there. So there's also a little high social theory too, that you probably all know about. I mean, you know, you get, you might have suspected that something like this would happen if you read Foucault and Butler. So, in conclusion, whether you want to build a laser or help get children better nourished in Bangladesh, you need theory, and more theory. Theories, so the kind of theories you need, which is a list of bunches, theories of the instruments, theories of what methods can do, theories on the right measures, that give sense to our concepts, that bridge between different levels of description, etc., etc. So we need huge sets of theories of all types and sources. So big theory is here to stay. Thank you.
They interviewed someone who was using randomized control trials, and their interviewer was skeptical in the way that you are, that let's say their local tribal results or whatever were generalized to a different community. But I was somewhat relieved to read a bit, because the way I read it is in some sense in a bit like they're in a psychoanalytical phase, some people, and you wouldn't hear of Freud using randomized control trials and think, oh, but he's not using enough theory. You'd probably think he was already using too much.
Yes.
And I wonder if there's just a sort of misreading of the state of this here, where it's not so much people are skeptical towards theory, it's more that they feel almost like Freud, in that they are a bit lost in nothing contacting the reality sufficiently. And they're using RCTs as a way of redressing the difficulty of debates resolving themselves, and the difficulty of theories competing, and the difficulty of actually coming up with something that works.
I think that's true. It's just that I don't think you can come up with something that works from the randomized controlled trial. You can test that worked in a given setting. And I think there's a good reason to be suspicious, because if you think about deworming and reading, mm-hmm. right, there's nothing inbuilt in worm medicine that's meant to improve reading scores. You might think that being a massive object has a kind of natural inbuilt tendency to attract other masses, but that's just not true of deworming medicine. It has, in a sense, a natural tendency to smother. I think what it does is it starves the worms. It upsets the balance and starves the worms. So there's a long chain of steps to get from giving the kids deworming medicine. They actually have to swallow it. They have to have shoes so they don't get that. Except to getting them to be in school more often, because often if they're healthy, they can stay home and work. They can go to work. So they're in school more often. Then, et cetera. So there's a long chain, every step of which has to be in place if you expect the improvement of reading scores. So I often joke, I've got a picture of Eton School and Kenyon School, and thinking, I don't think deworming works the same in the two places.
You might be surprised.
Yeah. Okay, so anyway, you see the point. So I'm going to have a really grounded reason for thinking that you shouldn't think that you can learn something about the power of deworming pills to improve reading scores. You can see that, you can begin to think about the chain by which they might do it, what the principle is that works at every stage. If you think about that, you can wonder what kind of support factors need to be in place to allow the first step to happen, and then to allow the second step to happen. I have this real worry that that's the first one. And then the second is, I'm pretty sure they have been caught along, not just because it's really good to have some evidence, but also because they provide an objective thing to point to resolve political debate. Mm-hmm. I mean, whether it's a good thing to point to, but I mean, there's something out there, somebody has put an endorsement on it, we know something, right? And so opposing fact, and it really has played that political role, I think.
Hi,
Ian.
So I suppose economics, so do you think there's a problem specifically with economics in terms of previously it's had a lot of very bad theory? So everyone's a rational actor, will make these massive assumptions, but oh look, it fits the data, so it's good. It's a good theory because it fits the data. Well, yeah, exactly, right, yeah. Entirely so.
Some of the data, some of the time.
Yeah, so do you think is it particularly a problem with economics getting to a grip with how to use theory well? Or like, and is that something this like little theories can help with, because we can like stop doing big things?
I think that's part of the story. I'm just reading something by the Keynesian economist Robert Skidelsky, Keynesian biographer, who says, you'll all love this, whether you believe all the little bits he says, but what's wrong with economics is they don't talk enough to philosophers and sociologists. And they start talking to social scientists, they start talking to psychologists, like Danny Kahneman. So we have none. Anyway, but the big theories, but there have always been lots and lots of detailed small models and causal models that work pretty well, and very good econometric modeling. So it's not, there are these big grand theories that have replaced one another, from Keynesian to monetarism and so forth. And nobody's very happy, not nobody, but lots of people are not happy with those. But there also going to hold. So it's not clear to me why. It's the old expression, throwing the baby out with the bathwater. So you've got something new that you can do, and it's a little tiny thing you can do, and it's really good. And you know, it's a new tool in your toolbox. And but then the things that we do know how to do otherwise. So it does have. I think they all say it has to do with this credibility revolution. I don't know how much time we have. The instrumental variables approach. Is what you do, or a natural experiment, is you find something that happens somewhere naturally that you can't, like minimum wage. Okay, you can't just say, I'm going to have two populations, I'm going to have minimum wage here and not there, and assume that their structure is similar to begin with. But maybe you can find some place when minimum wage was instituted in a way that made you think it was probably independent of most other causal variables. So this minimum wage caused more or less unemployment. Okay. And so instrumental variables got to be a big thing. It's the instrument, it's not, you're not controlling it, but you look for a case where it happened like that. And so there was this famous New Jersey, Pennsylvania, New Jersey Institute at Pennsylvania Dint. I forgot the name of the way around. Anyway, and they're right, you know, it's just a continuous border and they're same population you're in. And then you reckon pretty much whatever's happening in Pennsylvania is happening in New Jersey. The populations are pretty much the same. And so that's an instrumental variable. Well, as soon as that's done, there was a whole movement doing instrumental variables. And then, you know, really clever people worry about it. And then they come along and they study these and they find that, actually, if you look at it, we think, I mean, here's something you didn't notice was going on in Pennsylvania. So your instrument wasn't good enough. You know, so you need to have random assignment. That's a bit of the recent history. Was that we got quite interested in the econometric models. In order to draw causal conclusions from an econometric model, you have to put in quite a lot of independent causal knowledge about other variables, not as many as we talked about much or anything else, but you have to put in a lot of antecedent causal knowledge. And you know, if you put in one cause, the two you think are related look causally related, you put in another hypothesized additional factor, and they get unrelated, you put in a third. But the thing is that it seems to me there was all that in the background. I mean, science is really hard. Finding things out is really hard. And so we got excited about one thing, and then we got excited about another. And somehow, you know, each new thing looks almost like a panacea. It's going to solve all these problems rather than it's just hard to put them all together. Does that sound plausible to you?
Yes,
what's going on?
Any other questions?
Thank you very much. What I would wonder is, in the account that you've given, is there room for verification of theories, or does your account not allow for that?
I think you can. you can have lots of good warrant for theory. I mean, I actually think, you know, depending on what you count your theory to be. I mean, if your theory is just a little theory about the average treatment effect in this room. Boy, we can nail that down pretty well, because I think I can control for a lot of the external factors that might affect. Can you, but we verify, I'm very happy with quantum theory. I don't think it's universal, but I think we know how to use it. And the way we use it, the ways we use it are highly warranted. But when I look at what warrants it, that's how I got this idea. You know, still, you know, you need to have all these little pieces working together. And it seems to me that that's what makes it reliable, is that we've got tons and tons and tons of development here, there, 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 and a lot of practice at putting them together. And then, you know, when we stick to the areas where it's the kind of thing we already know how to do, we get reliable results. It seems to me I observe that. and tracing the, what goes into it, I sort of can see why you would expect the results to be reliable, because you know, there's not much wiggle room by the time you've got all these pieces in place, and every one of them is itself, you know, been through a mill of competition and criticism and so forth.
So I'm interested in why you seem to hold quantum mechanics to a higher standard than economics, because in physics in general, it's an assumption that things that are true in one part of the universe are true in another. If you can control the outside factors like where on the Earth they are, but it's not really been proven. It's just a flatly assumed thing. And quantum mechanics in particular has massive problems with orthogonality because of the really strong effect that the observer has on observed systems.
Tell me, start again. Why do I think that quantum mechanics?
I don't disagree with you that randomized controlled trials seem to be used to make extensions to things that they didn't measure. But quantum mechanics
has problems.
Yes, yeah. And in particular, if the two problems you have with randomized controlled trials are that it's difficult to prove orthogonality and it's difficult to make extensions to different populations, one of them is assumed in most of physics, and the other one is just flatly wrong.
I don't actually, I think some things are assumed in physics, but there's a lot of extrapolation which depends on exactly this kind of piecing together tons of little pieces of work. So when Millikan measures the charge, the minimum charge of electricity on charges in his experiment, his oil drop experiment, he's only measuring things on those very charges in his experiment. And it isn't just an assumption that there's a minimum charge and that they're all the same. That itself is something that was, had a huge history to get it backed up. So that assumption, that kind of assumption isn't just an assumption, it's something that's been subjected to a lot of control. The idea that quantum theory, which we know how to use here, there, and many other places, is universally both true and universal, I've written a lot against that. So I don't want to, but I do think that we know how to use it in various places. We know how to use it in the way we use it in the theories of low temperature superconductivity is highly honed, and a lot of challenging work went into that. So I think it's probably reliable, not as a general universal theory that, I just think you couldn't possibly, that we're all in a quantum state at the moment. And Schrodinger's equation or some relativistic version of it or is pushing our quantum state forward. I just don't think we have evidence for that, but I do think we have evidence about how to do things with squids. The problem with the cases in development economics is that we just don't have, it's not that I worry about making a grand assumption. It's that we don't have the practice of making an assumption that we know how to use to actually get the new case.
Yeah. So it's not that you think that making assumptions wrong, but that the way they do it is wrong.
Well, I don't think they're making assumptions. I think that I actually have a lot of warrant for thinking all electrons have the same charge. And I think I have a lot of warrant for thinking that the way quantum theory is used to model what's going on a low temperature superconductor has a lot of warrant. And the way quantum theory is used to model, to build models of working lasers has a lot of support. My own view is I'm very cautious about what I believe, and so the idea that because I can use it for squids and lasers doesn't tell me that I'm in a quantum state. and I did work with Will Slam for a while who said, you know, it's really hard to get something into a quantum state. And other people who think, it's a universally true theory or something like it, it's replacement, characteristic will be right, they think, no, no, it's wrong, it's not hard, everything's in a quantum state. It's only hard for you to know what the quantum state is. But it seemed to me that he knew how hard he had to work to get something into a state that he had reason to think was in a quantum state. And I'm interested in what the warrant is for assuming we are in a quantum state. I have a really good reason for thinking that certain kind of superconducting materials are in a certain kind of quantum state.
Back there.
Thank you so much. I was wondering, so if we need all of these particular theories and theories and theories and top theories, it seems to get messy quite quickly.
Yes.
So, very nice, yeah. Having the same intonation.
I think science is really messy.
Yes, of course. So I was wondering if there is anything you want to talk about that sort of, is there any kind of systematicity that we could think about in the background, something like a theory without it being a theory, or what? How do we handle the messiness? Is that a thing where we ought to be pluralist about? Just look at the various cases and just go with whatever works in that case, or is there anything kind of
Certainly, I don't think there's a theory of theories. I mean, it's not just matter what I think. People have tried to think ones up and they haven't gotten anywhere. I do think you can, or I'm wondering whether you can get some rules of thumb about certain kinds of things. I've been doing this work on evidence-based policy, and with a colleague, Eleonore Montuski, who has been using as a case study the Vaillant Dam catastrophe in Italy about 2 decades ago. So they built a dam and worked really hard to study the rocks in which it was built, that they wouldn't collapse. So this is a bit of a long story, the kind of thing I was thinking you might be able to do. What happened was that there was a huge rock slide behind, and the rocks fell into the water and created a huge wave that went over the top of the dam and into the valley and drowned hundreds and hundreds of people. Okay. Now, what Eleonora suggests is that what the engineers who did it said, well, we didn't expect that. That's again a caricature. We didn't expect that because these kinds of rocks wear their troubles on their face. If there's a flaw inside them, and that's what happened, was that so there was nothing on the outside to suggest there was anything wrong with these. This, I think, was limestone. And generally, limestone wears its troubles on its face. So, you look at the rocks, and they're okay, right? On this occasion, they weren't. But there was a lot of local knowledge that there had been landslides in the past, and also local knowledge about some aspects of the stone, rocks. But could they have known that? I mean, how do you know when you should look for local knowledge and when you shouldn't? When you should go and actually look at the rocks. And so one rule of thumb that Eleonora suggested was a kind of straightforward one, which is almost a cost-benefit analysis. I mean, so maybe generally, you usually, if you are pressed for time and money, you have to go with what's generally true, unless, the cost of making a mistake is too high, in which case you ought to have gone and looked. So one of the things that she wants is to have when you're doing policy, a sort of checklist. I mean, how much, but the checklist is kind of funny. I mean, how do you decide what further theory you need? And maybe there wasn't local knowledge, maybe you need to actually go do some tests on the rocks. So, but the kind of thing she was thinking that you could have was a checklist that said, well, look, if you're actually putting it in a certain site, and if it goes wrong, a lot of people are going to suffer. You better, check out things that aren't nailed down 100%. So you better do the theory that's needed to, not just wing it, like this is generally true. I'm sorry, that was a long story, but it's just that to give you a flavor of that it's not very abstract and general, it's, you know, sort of, but looking at cases to think, it's kind of obvious after the fact that you should be doing that, but you know, we need to have it actually in a list that says, you know, here's the kind of additional bits of knowledge and assumptions and theorizing you need, you know, look to see what you would need if this is going to, you know, be too costly for good for all.
All right, I'm going to have to call it quits there. One final round of applause for Nancy.